somewhere else. You're from somewhere else.
March 5th.
Okay, great.
But I'm a constituent.
So this is what I'd like to do right now. I've got two. I want to provide an update on the Richmond-Santa Fe Bridge project, third lane. I also want to provide more information on the Sir Francis Drake 101 corridor project, or, you know, process. But first I want to give you a little context on traffic and congestion. I've gone to a couple economic state of the economy conferences or meetings in the last month or so. And it is so clear that what we're experiencing here in Marin County is being replicated all over the Bay Area. The economy in the Bay Area is booming. It is booming to the point where it's actually carrying the state of the state of California economy, and it's even influencing to a large degree the statistics for the country nationwide. I mean, that's how much of a force, an economic force right now the Bay Area is. So job, lots of job creation, a lot of job creation all over. That means more people commuting regionally. It also means more jobs here locally. We've had a 5% increase in jobs locally here in Marin County in the last year. There's 125,000 payroll jobs in Marin County. Over half of those are filled by people commuting in, and a little less, and over half of us who live here commute out to jobs.
These are private sector jobs.
These are payroll jobs, so that's not gonna payroll and also self-employed stuff that's gonna show up in the books. Doesn't account for some of the other sort of, I want to say, second economy sort of jobs that aren't necessarily reported, but really it's the bulk. So say 125 payroll jobs. The job growth over the last year, 5% of that job growth, or the 5% job growth is primarily in the personnel services, retail, healthcare. So that tells you that probably most of those people are also commuting in. We also have an amazing amount of local construction, home improvement projects going on. People have a lot of housing turnover in the last few years, and a lot of improvements being made, people making improvements to their homes. That drives up traffic. And then again, we've got this school age boom, which has driven up. We've got the schools are at probably as high a point in terms of population as they've been since the 70s, but actually in fewer schools, because since the 70s, many schools closed down schools. We have more cross-school traffic. So all these factors combined, and that's what we're experiencing regionally as traffic flows through from San Francisco and the East Bay and parts north, regional traffic coming to us to work at jobs here, and our own traffic that we're generating just on our local streets and roads. As we drive more, the statistics on car registration are just like this, population is like this, car registration is like that. So there's a lot going on. So what do we do about it? Obviously this third lane on the Richmond-Santa Fe Bridge is really key. It's an obvious bottleneck. It backs up, we all know it backs up 101 both ways, northbound, southbound, it clogs up all the arterials. Somebody from San Rafael, if you're from Lomita Park, who was here from Over the Hill? Are you from Over the Hill in San Rafael, Lomita Park area?
I'm above Green Bay.
Above Green Bay. So we're seeing this phenomenon now in recent weeks and months of a lot more cut-through traffic coming, getting off of Sir Francis Drake, heading over the hill, dropping down into Woodland, Auburn area, and flowing out, and or even the Wolf Grade. So it's a mess out there. The Richmond-San Rafael Bridge third lane project has been accelerated thanks to Assemblyman Mark Levine and Senator Mark McGuire, and then all the rest of us here, local officials, getting on board, pressuring the legislature to try to fast track that project. May not seem very fast. It's now they've probably shaved a year to 18 months off the project. Something that would take 3 to 5 years now should take less than 3. They're anticipating it will be open, construction to begin the latter part of next year, open in 2017. So it does seem like a ways off, but it is happening, and it's happening more quickly than generally highway projects happen. That will make an enormous difference. It will make a difference in traffic flow, as long as we also address Sir Francis Drake proper, East Sir Francis Drake, and some of those, and getting to the bridge from there, and also up at Bellum, up in San Rafael. That has to be improved, and ultimately, we need a direct connection between 101 and 580. Unfortunately, that kind of freeway overpass project, if there were total agreement on it, would take probably 10 years. It's a long-term fix, getting a direct connector. But there are some short-term fixes that can be made to make the improvement or the connection from Centerfeld North 101 to the 580 smoother through Bellum. So I'm working with folks on the TAM board, including Dan Hilmer from Larkspur and other people in the Ross Valley toward really pushing for that 580-101 and Sir Francis Drake to the Richmond-San Rafael Bridge to make the improvements there that then will really make the third lane project on the bridge that much more effective. So that's our regional, more of a regional traffic issue, but it also has impact on the streets locally, so that's why it's so important. And then the second project I want to talk about and urge you to participate in, because it's in the community planning phase, is the Sir Francis Drake from 101 to the Ross border. It's a Sir Francis Drake improvement project and has five goals. One, to improve traffic flow. Improve traffic flow, reduce congestion, pedestrian improvements around a lot of the crosswalks and intersections. We have a lot of intersections that are feeding schools. We need to make safety improvements for kids using those, and even down towards Bon Air along through the corridor there. What can we do on those intersections to improve not only the way the lights are timed and traffic flow, but towards making it easier and quicker for folks to cross back and forth? Because right now you've got these wide avenues. If someone's pushing the button to cross, that's a long time for someone to walk across. What can you do to make it a shorter span? You can do bulb outs on the corners of intersections. What can you do to make the sidewalks more contiguous? We've got a lot of things that can happen to make this corridor function much more efficiently, both for traffic and for pedestrians, and even for bikes in some areas. It is in the planning phases. We had a really KPAG-sponsored a recent presentation by the folks that are the team that's working on this project that shows where we are to date in the planning process and the ideas that have been generated by the community for how to improve, what our priorities are for improving this corridor. They're taking an input, and they're going to come back again on the 18th of November, a meeting over here at College of Marin at Fusselman Hall, 7 o'clock, where they're going to present sort of what they've come up with to date in terms of alternatives for the different segments of the corridor. And this is, again, looking for community member feedback on their ideas, on priorities, and also just input, because you are all the users of this corridor. You know how it functions. But the good news is you can't make the road bigger. Well, to me, that's good news. I don't want more freeway, but I want it to work better. And they really feel like the traffic modeling they're doing and working with the intersections and light timing and all sorts of things, they're seeing in the modeling that we can make some real improvements to the way traffic flows through the corridor. It's been very reaffirming, the research they're doing, and they'll share that. And then again, getting your input and feedback on what could be proposed. They'll finalize designs, alternatives in the spring, come back to the community, and then when we're ready to push go, we push go and do the environmental review and then the project itself, which is likely not to be until 2017. It sounds a long ways away, but it's actually 12 to 18 months away. So. But it is our opportunity to improve this corridor, make some significant improvements to the corridor, and it's an opportunity that will not come up again for probably decades, because it's a significant investment. So we want to do this right, and that's why it's important that we really do get the good input, good feedback, and nail down a project that the community can embrace. So those are two, one regional traffic congestion problem issue that we need to address, and I think we're getting towards it, and then more locally, the Sir Francis Drake one. I work also very much at the local level on more of our surface streets around our schools. I'm not going to talk about that unless somebody has a question, but working a lot with the Kentfield School District, the McAllister neighborhood, on how we can get school kids to basic school more safely in that neighborhood, working with the Safe Routes Task Force at Kent Middle School towards actually looking at a yellow bus pilot here in Kentfield, similar to what we're doing in the Ross Valley, again towards getting kids out of their parents' cars and into some sort of alternative transit. And the yellow bus program, I'll just make this one pitch. A yellow bus program today is not the same as a yellow bus, the yellow bus in the old days. It wouldn't be about serving every single kid in the district. It would be about targeting those populations that are most likely to be driven to school. For instance, Green Bray doesn't have alternatives. They cannot, like, you know, farther down in Green Bray, too far to walk and bike to school, not safe. So, and there's a real cluster of kids in the Green Bray area coming to Basage in Kent Middle School. That would be a population to try to pick up on a yellow bus. So research is going into it, but it's really very much more of a targeted yellow bus service aimed at getting the most bang for the buck, and it does cost a buck, actually. It's not, yellow bus service will not be provided by the schools. It's going to be take money from the transit district and families actually ponying up to pay for it. But in the Ross Valley, it's working. We've got 500 out of 800 kids taking the bus to and from school at White Hill Middle School. So you can only imagine if those kids were not on the bus, what it would be like on Sir Francis Drake in the upper Ross Valley. So those are the two traffic things I wanted, or three traffic things I wanted to talk about. I expect we're going to have some questions about the Marin Catholic Stadium lights proposal, which is yet to be a formal proposal to the county. I see somebody here. Lisa Mago might be able to talk about it, yes?
I'm not Lisa Mango.
Oh, I'm sorry. No. You look like Lisa Mango.
Yeah.
You're both beautiful. Okay, well, I want to provide a little bit of information as much as I have, and then invite you to attend a meeting that Marin Catholic is putting on next week, next Wednesday the 12th.
Thursday the 12th
at
Basage Community Center.
At Basage, what time?
7 o'clock. And that's on this sheet. You guys want to pick this up?
Yeah, we've got a yellow sheet here that has a list of all the upcoming meetings. So at Basage School, next Thursday, 7 o'clock, Marin Catholic is hosting a community meeting to present to the community their proposal for putting lights on at the stadium in Marin Catholic. They are doing, on their own volition, a community outreach project process on this project before submitting to the county. I don't know when they might submit a proposal to the county. I think it is wise of them to do this community outreach to begin with and get a feel from the community about how they would respond to lights and potentially night football games, what have you. But I don't really know the parameters of what they're proposing in terms of use. So I think I'm going to be attending the meeting on Thursday. I encourage anyone who's interested in this issue to attend the meetings and provide your input to the school on how you feel on what they're proposing and or how they might modify their proposal to make it more acceptable to the community, if at all. And I'm expecting that we will have very strong opinions on this issue, both sides, all sides, very strong. And I'll be listening really carefully also to the community as you go through this discussion. And I think the school is trying to be as receptive as possible to input, and therefore I encourage a respectful and communicative participation on the part of the community so the school gets to hear how the community feels. Brent.
I think I agree with you that it's a good idea for them to have this community outreach, which I think the Planning Commission last time around told them that they should do. What I find puzzling is that they have only posted it to people through Green Bray Next Door, which a lot of people aren't on, or through Jack Dallinati's email, which doesn't go to that many people in Green Bray, frankly. I used to be the president of the GPOA, as you know, and Jack knows as well that it's not that great of distribution, unfortunately. So unfortunately, they didn't go. All they had to do was mail out to Vista Grande, Almanar, Corta Balboa, Corta Anita, Corta Elena, Medina, Corta Komoda, Manor. I mean, I could go on and on, and they know the addresses. All you have to do is get on Google and look. Yeah. And so I'm disappointed that this outreach using the big facility of the community center over at Basage with being so limited in publication. I think that's too bad. And I do know that they're trying to pack the place themselves with MC supporters. I've seen emails and things, you know, they're kind of intramural. Why would it be intramural? The whole point is to get us there, not to get them there. So yeah. It shouldn't be us and them, and I agree with you, it should be a good discussion, and it shouldn't be people yelling at each other, but it's already set up as we're only going to be there because we found out about it through various ways, not direct ways, frankly, and we're getting each other there by going door to door and saying, this is an important issue, and you have to get there. So I'm starting out as having kind of a negative feeling about the so-called outreach.
Yep. So I will share that with the folks through my communication channels, because I actually think they have an opportunity to do a little bit more outreach in advance of next Thursday. But I also don't know that this is the only meeting they're going to have. So I think it probably up front they should address how much process they anticipate on having, and then I don't know all the avenues they use to do outreach on. I think it's good constructive criticism, frankly, up front.
There's time, Katie, but there's only 4 or 5 days. There's very little time to do
right.
extra.
So that's why it's important, and I actually was asking, checked in this week, how much, what is this community process going to look like? And right now it's open-ended, so this is the first meeting.
Well, also, there's only one chance to make a first impression, so I'm really surprised that this would be the way that they want to make the first impression to us, which is we're going to, not hide, but we're going to open up this issue, but not really contact all of you that are interested in it. It's a very strange way to open up such an important issue. So
it's a very normal way. It's not strange at all.
So I think that's really valid criticism, and let's hope that they have, if your first impressions do make a difference, but they also have the ability to communicate with the community, and they should take the time to do it, and I'm going to be encouraging them to do that. I'll push out as well. I have a pretty extensive list. So, yeah, these guys went first.
Oh, go ahead.
Thank you. This proposal has been around since the 90s. That was the first time I heard about it. And as a dad, my kids are out of the house now, but I'm a big advocate for youth sports. Mm-hmm. I live basically across the street from Marin Catholic. I know one of the things that are traditionally done, whether it's the EIR process or some other type of process, is an alternatives analysis. Mm-hmm. I have an alternative that I would like to be addressed, and that is the creation of night football facilities around the McGinnis Park area, or that part of Marin County towards the St. Vincent's Orphanage property. There could be multiple sports facilities up there. A lot of the high schools would be able to use it, and you get, that's the way to overcome these massive neighborhood objections. And it's just not this community that's opposed to it. I've done outreach to the other neighborhoods that are near high school fields, and I asked them about it, and so therefore I would request, you know, you in the position of the Board of Supervisors, is to encourage an alternative analysis, something along the lines of what I am talking about, so the people can enjoy night football, and they can enjoy it in a way where it's not impacting these established neighborhoods where, let's face it, there is resistance to it.
Yeah, good point. So I don't know, because I don't know what the proposal is yet, whether or not CEQA will be triggered, but I expect that it probably would be triggered. It depends on what their proposal is. So
well, let me just add one thing. The reason I say St. Vincent's, and I don't know this, but I think it's owned by the Catholic Archdiocese, and there's some maybe ability, because it's similar, I don't know if it's true, but.
Yeah, your point's well made.
Thank
so
you.
Two things, I mean, you're raising two important points. One, what sort of process, official planning process, will this project go through? And we won't know until we know what the proposal is, what it will trigger, but it seems like it would trigger a CEQA. The CEQA process, which requires some alternatives analysis, at least some initial studies, and alternatives analysis, might be that regional. I actually think that regional solution is even bigger than MC and probably should be picked up by multiple schools at the same time.
I'd pay for it. I'd want my taxes, you know.
And then same thing, you know, and then every site, whether it's in a neighborhood, near a neighborhood or not, most of this county is already zoned for whatever uses. There's my knowledge of the county zoning, there's not a lot of stuff that's zoned for some a use like this. Hamilton, you know, up in Hamilton now, they're just talking about a soccer sports complex. So there's no easy solutions in this. On the other hand, there is a high demand, and we don't have enough capacity for youth sports. So it's a community conversation with regards to the MC lights. CEQA will be triggered. We won't know if it'll be triggered until they submit an application. The project proposal could be very narrow in scope or very broad in scope. We need to wait and see what comes up in the formal planning process once they submit an application. And in the interim, this outreach and community feedback is really important on this single proposal. I can't really talk more about it. I do think, how many people are here out of specifically interest around the MC project? Okay. But people are generally interested anyway, yes? Okay. Well, definitely be participating in these early meetings. Mr. Nessel, where are you from?
I'm from the St. Vincent's neighborhood. And I just want to say, you know, pushing traffic up and lights and up into my neighborhood is an issue. And I too support youth sports, but this is not so simple as just putting it into another neighborhood.
I think he used that as a hypothetical.
I understand, yeah. But I'm just wanting to hear
pushback no matter where.
There will be some kind of pushback. And actually, with regards to zoning up at St. Vincent Silvera, that land all has been zoned and it does not include anything that would.
But we can always change the zone.
You can. I'm just saying that there's no, it's not simple, but I think the point is well made and the demand is there, but the solution is more difficult to come by.
So we have just spent all this time talking about traffic. Mm-hmm. And what a nightmare it is. And this project that they want to come with, and they've stated on their website in the letter that came out that it was supposed to be for 10 meetings at night on Friday night and any other time that they choose during the week for a variety of other sports and maybe other activities.
Sure.
From a traffic standpoint alone, mm-hmm. You think their stadium can hold about 1,500 people, so you figure a right around rush hour on Sir Francis Drake Boulevard, you could be adding an extra 1,000 cars. And where are they all going to park?
Yep.
They want to talk about the hospital parking lot, which hasn't been completed yet, and probably is going to cost money to park there. Mm-hmm. Kids coming down aren't necessarily going to want to pay for parking. They're going to park in the neighborhood, the surrounding neighborhoods. You know, it's going to increase the traffic flow no matter how you look at it when we're trying to go in the opposite direction. And that's only one aspect of this project.
Yes.
Not even addressing the noise and the light and the, you know, air pollution and, you know, and the marsh animals that live right behind Marin Catholic. I mean, there's a whole environmental issue that we need to be addressing.
And these are all, that you hit on all, those are going to be the key issues.
Yeah.
Traffic, noise impact, light, environmental impact. I'm trying to remember who.
I think I have my hand on that.
Front,
so I'm here for general interest in growth issues, traffic, and all of that, and just to learn more about what's going on in our community. Talking about Marin Catholic, hearing you speak, one thing that I wanted to sort of just express what I'm anticipating, because I was involved, attended all the meetings at APAD and at the Board of the Planning Department at Civic Center a couple years ago when it was up, is it's going to be very political. Marin Catholic is going to come out in force. That's a very great school, and they've got a lot of people that are going to rally around their school as they should and around you know, youth sports and all these positive things, and I want everyone to see that it's going to be politics, because that's not your constituents, and that's not, you know, what people generally feel. That's just people rallying around the cause, and so it's going to look optically a lot different than what the people that live in your community believe in, which is, you know, a peaceful
beautiful community, stars at night, beautiful Mount Tam, looking while we all live in Marin. And it is going to look, there's going to be a lot of people at Marin Catholic meeting. I'll be there. I've read the website. I would expect that they will have hundreds of people. They're very positive about this experience for kids, and it's going to look different than what people will think.
I recognize that.
But Suzanne is saying...
And Suzanne, I think, and I recognize, having been to enough meetings on really controversial subjects, that who fills the room is not always representative of all the voices in the community. And I also, I'm going to reach out to actually Marin Catholic in advance of Thursday, and really encourage them to be as encouraging as possible of actually hearing all points of view here, and because it can be pretty intimidating actually when you fill a room.
Right.
So, and I don't think there's anything nefarious. I think they're a school that want to do well, but it's a big community.
There's a lot of people that believe in that. I mean, obviously Larry seems to believe in the whole youth sports franchise. I mean, I grew up in Marin. That's not part of my life experience. There's a Marin Catholic Redwood volleyball game at Redwood tonight that if people want to go to youth sports, I encourage them to go to that. But I don't see a place for Marin. I've seen the show, and I know that's part of a lot of places in the country, but it's not where I live.
Yeah. Is your daughter on the volleyball team?
She was. She's okay. At college now.
Yeah. Right.
I kind of misread the format of the meeting. I thought you were going to make comments and then questions afterwards. So
well, I did my. I was really focused on the traffic, and then I didn't do the formal transition into comments and questions.
I was just thinking. I hope there are more questions than mine about traffic, but we all kind of went
through
that.
We'll move on to some other stuff now.
My question is, and just because I am the, neighbor, not an engineer, not involved in the process, mm-hmm. but the whole Richmond Center Club Bridge thing,
yeah.
Is there something, is the bicycle thing what's making it? Because it seems to me that the top of the bridge, take all those dividers out, take all the crap out there, paint some lines, and boom, we're open. Why does it take 3 years?
Well, it's the bottom part of the bridge, right?
Is that's where the third lane's going to be?
Well, no, the third lane's right. Not both ways.
But I mean, get rid of half the problem. Can't we do that tomorrow?
So two things. If you could just restripe the third lane, it should be 6 months, at the most.
That's better than a year and a half.
Right, but it's not just restriping the third lane, because when the bridge was originally built and could accommodate three lanes, there have been changes made on the approaches, mm-hmm. on the eastbound side. If you recall, when you come off the bridge, you go around a corner, there's a large retaining wall.
Yep.
That actually was put in post the third lane project. It needs to be moved, it needs to be shaped back. There's no way around it. They were trying to figure out how can you configure the three lanes and have appropriate sight distance, because you can't come around a corner like that at a certain speed and not have it be a safety concern. That retaining wall, which is enormous, mm-hmm. has to be moved back. That's one significant project that takes engineering and has to go through environmental review. And then on our side of the bridge, there's actually questions about the integrity of the infrastructure, getting onto the on-ramps there, and there are physical improvements that need to be made there. So whenever you're talking about a major roadway project, highway project, I mean, you're talking 3 to 5 years minimum, because you have to go through, it's a Caltrans project and or it's a, this in this case, it's the Bay Area Toll Authority is involved. They have to go through the regulatory process, permitting process. Any of you know, if you've tried to do any projects in your own home that involve a region, let alone your own local county planning process, which can take weeks if not months. You get to the regional stage or the regional agencies and it's a longer process. So you figure usually nine to 18 months just for the regulatory, and then you do your construction, which makes things, your design and construction, which makes it for a 3-year project minimum. And this is this is big. So I'm pleased that we've been able to, with Levine's help, frankly, and also Contra Costa's help. I mean, this isn't just a Marin County issue, this is a Contra Costa issue. So we've all gone on the same page and made it actually as short as you can possibly make a
project. What do the bicycles have to do with it now?
Bicycles aren't holding up. The bike lane The bike piece is not holding up the timeline here. If it were only the bike piece that have to happen, probably that would go more quickly. If it were only the bike piece.
Is it 3 years from now?
No. So they're thinking, they're going the environmental and the design right now. Should be done before the end of this coming year, 2016. And they were talking about starting construction in 2016 so that it's open in 2017. And I know it seems like a long time, but I can tell you that's actually a pretty compressed time frame for what has to happen. And it's more than just putting three lanes. It's more than restriping.
But the other question I have is about Sir Francis Drake.
Yes.
One about they've identified that there can be some traffic signal changes that would help things.
Yeah.
Has that been done yet? Or are we going to wait a year and a half to do that too?
No, it's traffic signal changes along with intersection changes. So I'm going to give you one example so you can understand. So think about what's the first intersection when you're heading east, you get off the bridge, the first intersection is
Elysium and Berry.
So right now, because of the way that intersection is sort of off kilter, intentionally, I'm sure, you have split left turn. So that means if you're heading one, it has to give a solo for folks coming out of the shopping center wanting to take a left to head west on Sir Francis Drake, they get their very own. The folks on the other side, on the La Cuesta side, are waiting to make their left turn or go straight. Well, they have to get their own light. So just by reconfiguring the intersection so you can do left-hand turns at the same time, you've eliminated, 45 seconds of light time. That's really a very simple example, but it involves more than just signal timing. It actually involves some physical improvements. And that's the kind of thing they're looking at. And you start to add it all up. And they've got state-of-the-art traffic modeling software being applied to this. And in fact, at the meeting at KPAD, Mark Wittenkeller, who's on the GPOA,
he's on CSA 16.
He's on CSA 16 and very familiar with the technology. He was like, yes, team, you've got the best traffic modeling technology that being applied to this, looking at the project, and they think that there's definitely ways to improve flow. It only takes, your traffic is flowing smoothly, fairly full, and it doesn't take much to tip the scale. So a 5% increase in traffic can mean the difference between things are working really well to it's gridlock. With these sort of signal light timing and intersection improvements, they really think they can make a difference.
Katie, do you know, are they going to address the East Sir Francis Drake issues as well?
Not as part of this project,
because that's certainly a pinch point.
Totally. But I've actually pushed, so one of my big issues with the way government and agencies work here in Marin County, and I suppose elsewhere, they don't talk to each other. So coordinating, having a county project talk to a city of Larkspur project used to be unheard of. And what we've done is now, even though this project is funded separately, I've got County Public Works talking with Larkspur about how do we deal with that phase that goes through Larkspur so that we can actually link together projects and have these agencies talking together, because it's just ridiculous. And Brian's leaving, but that Richmond-San Rafael third lane bridge doesn't do a lot of good until we also fix it. We have to fix the approach.
Yeah, no, I got it. Thank you very much.
So what I hear,
okay. Just one second, I'm gonna go right here.
Well, I had a question about the bike bridge at the ferry building. It was supposed to cost $10 million, and now it's up to $20 million. Why is that?
The bike bridge that's just laid down over
at the ferry.
Yeah, so that, actually, I don't think it was $20 million. I think it came in, it was supposed to be $8 or $9 million. I remember way back when it was proposed, and I think it ended up costing $13 or $14 million. There was cost overruns, the timing, things, during the recession, costs were down. Those were where the original estimates were made around how much it would cost to do the project. Prices have increased since. It is pretty much close to done. And it came in way over budget. And it was funded through transportation monies that were directed specifically at bike and ped improvements. And it's water under the bridge or bikes over the road at this point. And frankly, we will see a benefit of having that there once it's opened up, because right now, if you're a bike or a pedestrian and you come down to cross from the Larkspur Landing side, the theater side, over mm-hmm. to the ferry side, you hit the pedestrian crosswalk button and you get to cross while all the traffic waits. So to be able to get some of this traffic to cross the Sir Francis Drake over Sir Francis Drake will actually be a traffic congestion relief opportunity. So yeah, it's a ton of money, I hear you. But actually, it will help in the end with traffic congestion. And yes, I'm sorry.
Yeah, I'm reminded, since I almost got run over by a bicycle here right before this meeting started, that Marin County and associated agencies have spent millions of dollars on bicycle infrastructure, mm-hmm. and the traffic just continues to get worse and worse. And have we gotten it through our thick skulls yet that this doesn't help the traffic? Is this going to come to an end?
Two responses to that. It feels like an amazing, it is an exorbitant amount of money that's been spent on bicycle infrastructure improvements. The big physical improvements are the ones that really cost a lot of money. The ones that don't cost a lot of money are just the are the lane striping and sort of more surface street improvements, which actually are a lot of the improvements that have been made. They have less of a price tag, but they have made it easier and for folks to bike around this community. And whether we may not think it's helping, but I can tell you in my neck of the woods, in San Anselmo and Fairfax, the bike improvements, it's called facility improvements, but really it's more around a striping and creating dedicated bike lanes, makes a difference in terms of how much traffic is on the streets. Those hundred kids who bike to school in the morning from Fairfax to White Hill School, on top of the 500 kids who are taking the bus, means 600 kids are not driving to school.
Yeah,
it makes a difference.
I'm hoping these elementary school and middle school kids are not on Sir Francis Drake in the middle of the traffic with their bicycles. They need to be off.
Think about Sir Francis Drake and alternate routes. So in Fairfax, if you're familiar, the safe routes, the school pathway, the infrastructure, striping, and signage that's been done to take kids to White Hill School is not on Sir Francis Drake. It detours them around. They take alternative routes. And again, if there's alternative routes and there's been an effort to get these kids onto bikes rather than cars, and it means one less car on Sir Francis Drake. Well, I hear what you're saying, but I think also, I'm thinking about my kids. I'm thinking about the next generation. I'm thinking about my brother who lives in Mill Valley, two brothers-in-law who live in San Rafael in the Sun Valley area, and up in San Anselmo. They bike to the ferry. These two bike to the ferry 3 days a week. My brother and another brother-in-law, in fact, in Mill Valley, they bike to the city from Mill Valley. There are people who are choosing to get out of their cars because they feel that they have a safe way to go. It makes a difference for congestion. And I know, having spoken to my parents who get so upset about the bikes that are blowing through stop signs, that's not the community that we're trying to encourage. Those are recreational bikers. What we're trying to focus on here are the folks who are willing to get out of their cars, ride their bike or walk or take transit, because all that stuff adds up towards making traffic flow more freely for those of us who still are needing to drive. So it's going to take it all. It is going to take it all, but I hear very loudly from the community, let's stop with the major infusion of cash and transportation dollars into bike improvements. We need to work on the auto traffic problems we've got.
Well, I went to that
KPAT
meeting.
Yeah.
And the most impressive thing about that meeting was how those traffic engineers managed to figure out how to spend all the money.
Yeah. Well, it's not cheap. So that project, we have $13 million.
And it's going to disrupt traffic while you try to make some of these improvements.
Well, that's part of
without making such an enormous difference in the traffic.
I think we have to try to do something, because nobody's satisfied with the status quo. So, let's see, who was next? You guys have to self-regulate.
I just want to go back to this third lane on the Sanford Bridge. And from what you have just said, then it sounds to me that Mark Levine's proposal to the assembly to get that done within 6 months is a dead issue, and that he's not pushing that anymore, because everything I've read in the IJs, he continued to push for that as an easy fix, even though I was aware of some of these other constraints too. But what I'm hearing from you is that's really not going
to happen. He had two bills. He had the one to do the concurrent design and environmental to make those processes happen at the same time. And that is the bill that went through that shaves 12 to 18 months off the project. He had another bill that was asking for an emergency opening of the third lane, you know, somehow manage the traffic so those safety issues and approaches can be mitigated, you know, the safety issues can be mitigated. And that did not ever make it out of a committee. It was actually part of a special session they did on transportation, and it, like many other bills, just died for lack of push through. So he can continue to push for this, but realistically, all those bills, that one and some others, and many others, are dead in the water for right now. The state has an issue right now that they have to figure out how to create funding streams for transportation improvement and maintenance projects. We have both at the federal level and the state level, the gas tax has not been indexed. They were put in place in the 90s. They haven't increased over time. And so the amount of revenue states receive and our local communities receive here from the state gas tax continues to decline, and yet we have all this infrastructure that's been put in place over the last, you know, 30 and 40 and 50 and even 60 years ago that is needing to be maintained. And in fact, as probably there's been deferred maintenance, and there's not enough money to take care of those roads. So anyway, it's an issue. So that bill's dead. The other one helped. Ann.
So during the Wind Cup and Larkspur Landing Station area plan, those of us who were concerned about it first became aware of two organizations, MTC and ABAC. And now the situation is that they are proposed to merge. It's very confusing for community members to understand, you know, what each agency does and why they should be separate or why they should be merged. What do you think is in the best interest of us in the local community?
That's a really good question. So the two agencies Anne's talking about, ABAG is the Association of Bay Area Governments. It was established by statute back in, I want to say, the 50s. And it basically is a government body that representatives from each of the cities and towns and counties from throughout the Bay Area sit on the Association of Bay Area Governments. And it's basically towards around land use, emergency planning, community resiliency. Those are the kinds of things that ABAG looks at and tries to not necessarily coordinate, but at least support regional thinking and communities and towards making improvements and or doing their land use policy and or emergency planning, what have you, that has impacts on contiguous towns. So it's really more around land use side of the house for regional government. Because many years ago, way back in the 50s and over time, there's been many, many studies, this Bay Area the Bay Area leaders in the Bay Area community recognized everyone couldn't operate in isolation. So the degree to which, though every community has local autonomy, the degree to which you could try to get communities to talk to each other could only help in terms of not, you know, banging into each other. I don't know how successful ABAG's been over time, but it exists as a very unique and separate body around land use primarily, but really more not without a mandate to force land use policy, but a mandate to try to encourage regional thinking. MTC, Metropolitan Transportation Commission, is all about transportation. It is the body that captures state and regional funding, or state and national funding, that then flows to the local jurisdictions for our road improvements, for bridge improvements, for highway, for what have you. they manage transportation. And they have, MTC is quite powerful in that it does hold the purse strings for the bulk of the money that local communities get for transportation improvements. Over time, this is another one of these issues that comes up every 10 or 15 years. MTC was also created by the state legislature after ABAG, but I want to say in the 60s, maybe, probably around the 60s, early 70s, I'm not sure about that. So it's a state mandated body, also regional thinking around transportation. Every, it seems to be a 10, 15 year cycle where comes up, should those two regional bodies be merged? And the last time it came up, I want to say it was in the 90s, there was a big study done, nothing happened. My opinion as to whether those bodies should be merged, I'm less inclined to change the status quo because of how different these two bodies are in terms of their connection to the community. ABAG, for all of its bad reputation, actually has really come along in terms of being much more connected to the local communities. We each have a representative on that board. MTC is a little bit more distant. We have the one board county supervisor, Steve Kinsey, who sits on MTC. The other counties also don't have as much representation. I mean, just so it feels a little bit more administrative and a little bit more removed from local government. So I would only be supportive of some merging if I felt like cities and counties had adequate representation on a merged body. And there was a proposal to merge, but actually it got backed up a little bit, and consensus was made not to merge, but to do some sort of analysis, a neutral objective analysis of what would be the benefits, the pros and cons of merging those two agencies, and what are the possibilities for how it looks. So that's that is something that will happen over the next course of the next year or so. And I'm not sure what it's going to result in. And until they come up with some recommendations, I'm not going to opine. I'm not ready to opine on whether I think it's a good idea or not. Mm. But mainly it's about we need to make sure that we have really strong local representation across the board on any of the regional agencies. Trying to get people who haven't asked me. Cindy.
Hi, Katie. In your newsletter, you said that you approve of the concept of joining 101 and 580, mm-hmm. but in the interim, you hope to see improvements on East Sir Francis Drake to make traffic flow more smoothly.
Right.
And I can see how that might be done from the Richmond Bridge to the main entrance of San Quentin. But once you take that corner around San Quentin and you're in your Luxor Landing, you come to a real pinch point for a variety of reasons. It's Larkspur Landing, the offices, the residences, the traffic mm-hmm. signals, the ferry and the SMART and the buses, and then the 101 junction. And I was wondering whether you were speaking as a general principle that you would like to see that done, or whether anyone has mentioned to you some specific ideas, because I'd like to hear them if they have.
Okay. I was definitely in principle. That I think we need to make improvements. We need to, you know, make that connection work better. And there are very specific, already identified improvements that can be made that I know of. One, right, just adding lanes, right turn lanes from when you drop down off of 101 onto Sir Francis Drake, heading east before you get to the ferry light. I mean, that's one element. I know that there has been look at, can you create a second lane post San Quentin? Is there room to make us two lanes? Because remember, it squeezes down to one. How can you improve that and on approaches? So I think there's specific elements that already have been identified that need to be fleshed out. And I'm not saying that there's a perfect solution, but I am fairly confident there's improvements that can be made on East Sir Francis Drake that will help get the cars off of 101 and headed to the bridge more quickly. And same with up at the at the north end in San Rafael, instead of that drop down off the freeway crossing Bellum is just, you know, a nightmare. There's got to be some way to improve that. And I'm not an engineer, but I think that's got to be doable. And I think we have to do short-term improvements. I think it'd be silly just to wait to make a direct 101-580 connection. That's going to take a while, but we need to start that as well. But it's going to take a long time.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
I have a question.
Yeah.
About when you're at Lucky Drive and you want to come home and go left, and then there's a big crowd of people that want to go right to East Francis Boulevard. And there used to be these sticks in the road, so people mm-hmm. couldn't right. cross over. And then all of a sudden the sticks are gone. And people literally are crossing over 3 and 4 lanes of
yep.
traffic. And there's never, ever a CHP policeman. There's never anybody around there. And then if you want to stupidly go from Greenbrae to a restaurant in Larkspur Landing between 4 and 6 o'clock, forget it, because you're not going to go anywhere. And then you get the people who try to sneak in, like they'll go in the far lane. You know, it's just a mess. And I would like to see, who do we go to? Because is it Central Marin Police Department? Is it the CHP? But there needs to be some presence there
mm-hmm.
so that people aren't crossing over
yeah.
all the time.
So it is the CHP. This
okay.
is with regards to those pylons,
yeah.
which were actually something that was added to managing traffic there,
mm-hmm.
I want to say within the last 5 to 7 years,
yeah.
and it
yeah.
did work. They always would get run over a little bit, and CHP would replace them, or not CHP, a Caltrans would replace
uh-huh.
them. And recently they made the decision to stop replacing them. And we actually made an inquiry about it, and it was around, one, safety issues for Caltrans, just because of the amount of traffic. And what was it, Nancy, was that primarily the driver?
That was primarily the reason.
Because they've been replacing them for years, and then they actually modified their policy, and they made a decision not to. Right?
Yeah.
And so, but we need to circle back. I'm guessing CHP is there sometimes ticketing, but they
yeah.
could do it more, definitely. The bigger, the
picture.
Bigger-ish picture,
yeah.
because that was only a halfway solution
right.
anyway, right? That was trying to deal with a really poorly designed crossover. Still, we had a lot of time, work, effort, design went into improvements, potential improvements, both northbound and southbound through the Greenbrae corridor. Among them was a big, huge overpass or new structure heading south that the community rightly objected to. There were other improvements, northbound, particularly, specifically to address that crossover issue, to separate traffic so that people who are, that whole industrial Lucky Drive on-ramp, not only is it unsafe, it creates a backup. There's also a backup created at Tamil Pious with cars coming on at Tamil Pious heading northbound. Every time
mm-hmm.
you have cars entering the freeway. So there was very specific design projects that would help on the northbound towards separating local traffic and the Richmond-San Rafael Bridge traffic and more generally regional traffic. And we needed to have the consent of both Larkspur and Corte Madera to make those improvements, because when you're touching any on-ramp or off-ramp that lands in a local jurisdiction, you have to, Caltrans requires the sign-off by those cities or towns. And Larkspur and Corte Madera basically opted out of any improvements by vote in terms of where they prioritized where the Greenbrae 101 monies went. I was advocating to at least make some improvements, but there was a pretty strong community groundswell, I think, that influenced both Larkspur and Corte Madera to invest instead in some more much more minor improvements that were more related to local traffic than addressing those major issues. But that work is still there, and it's still relevant, and it's still gone through environmental design. And I talked with Larkspur Council Member Hilmer, and frankly Larry Chu and their traffic committee, as well as Corte Madera, saying, when you all are ready, let's come back to the table on this and pull these off, because frankly it's ridiculous. And we had solutions, and the community pushed back, and we didn't get to make any of them. And I thought it was a crime, frankly.
Is that
on that subject?
Yeah.
The issue of that traffic and congestion.
Yeah.
It seems that there's no conversation going on about that massive complex
that's
built, and the fact that there's no correlation with traffic and that approval that was made. And this congestion we have seems to be under the radar quite a bit. And it's going to be a massive amount of people to move into that old Skyward from factory.
Right, right. Yeah, because it's not even occupied.
How did that get approved?
That was. No, I can get you the grand jury report and some articles on it. It really, it was.
The community needs that. I mean, it's a real question mark people have.
Yeah, fine. Thank you for coming. It's within the town of Corte Madera. And Corte Madera went through a planning process back in 2007, 2008. I think it was actually adopted, that project, as part of their general plan in 2009. There were all the requisite public meetings. I don't know that there was that much public participation. And frankly, in my view, it was really a poorly informed project. They could have done something there without doing something at that scale and level of intensity, but the council made a decision to create, to zone that for more housing. And I think also one of the things that people don't realize, it's not really affordable housing. It's actually market rate housing. Maybe 10% of it is for affordable housing. When the council, you know, to Corte Madera's, you know, I don't want to throw them under the bus, but in 2007, 2008, 2009, traffic was a lot. There was not as much traffic. It was a different world in terms of traffic. So I'm sure they had to do traffic studies then, and did those traffic studies anticipate the kind of growth that we had and the congestion? I'm not sure, but they have the ability, and I believe the council is actually trying to leverage improvements from the developer, some more money for improvements from the developer there, but we have not yet felt the impact of that development, you're right, and it does spill right out on the Corte Madera and Larkspur streets, and I'm hoping that that will incentivize those communities to actually get behind addressing some of these other issues right on the corridor that are making that area such a nightmare. And you're right, just crazy to drive over there if you don't have to. That's on your mind.
Keying off of that, the question I've been wanting to ask a long time is, can you comment on what is going on with the Larkspur Landing? About a year ago, there was a lot of news in the paper about plans for that. It's unclear to me who's in charge of that.
That is the city of Larkspur. And they went through this whole Larkspur Station area planning process, which culminated last year in them either, you know, making a decision whether or not to certify an EIR and certify whatever the plan was, which did change existing zoning and land use zoning and uses to a degree. And basically, after listening very hard because they couldn't help it to the community, they made a decision to actually table that. And the status, things are at the status quo. They shelved the Larkspur Station area plan for now. They did not act on it. I don't know that they have an intention to. I don't think it's about putting something off in the future. I just think they heard loud and clear, we can't even consider any changes in this area of Larkspur until these traffic issues are dealt with, and if they aren't dealt with, then, you know. So I thought Larkspur was very responsive that way. Because again, that Larkspur Station area planning process was all, you know, with good intentions. It was about planning for when SMART comes potentially to the area. It was trying to be forward looking, and the bulk of that process was happening during the recession, also when we were experiencing much larger traffic. So they heard the community and they put that Larkspur Station area plan down. And I think, you know, the silver lining of all these things, of Wind Cup and Larkspur Station Area Plan, is that there are people, the community members are paying a lot more attention and are a lot more involved in these conversations. And that may make it difficult for any, and everything gets longer the more community process you have, but it's just really critical to making sure that any of these towns or the county move forward in a way that makes sense for the community.
The other just topics, not questions, just to cover today. Do you know anything that's planned for Bonaire Shopping Center?
Oh,
and
yeah.
Then I was just curious, because if anyone that goes, there's something going on there. So
There's
lots of tenants are leaving, so I didn't know if it was.
Oh, well, that's maybe different. In terms of footprint or in terms of actual physical infrastructure, they're making changes to their parking lot and circulation. Nothing that I know of with regards to changing any physical improvements or expansions of the you know, the retail, the commercial areas themselves. they might be, you know, just going through tenant turnover.
Can I say something briefly? Because I live very near to the Bon Air Shopping Center, and they are just going to improve the parking and the circulation, and they're trying to make it more family friendly, akin to Marin Country Mart, because shopping center professionalism and marketing is changing now because so many people are going online. And I saw Tom Alport just a couple of days ago. I said, when are you going to start construction? And he said, not until El Nino is over this winter, because they have to do a lot of underground work, an immense expense for sewer pipes and electrical pipes and water pipes and all that sort of thing. So we're thinking about it.
Thank you, Cindy.
Thanks.
Yes.
So in all the years I've lived in Marin, going back to the 80s, occasionally we do have real winters where it rains. And of course, there's this discussion of the 101 Sir Francis Drake interchange on Lucky Drive. And when the tide is high and it rains, there's flooding on 101. And so there's flooding on 101 near the Lucky Drive during high tide and rain. Has there been a proposal put forth to construct a pumping system so there isn't the flooding on the highway when the rain and the high tide happen?
Very good question.
I personally paid some attention to the proposal a few years ago about the whole reconfiguration of the Drake 101. I didn't see anything in there about a pumping system so that flooding on the highway would be alleviated. But, you know, pumps have been around a long time. It's not high tech. It's not new tech.
No, and in fact, in Corte Madera, they have pumps and all sorts of drainage system around moving water during high tide, all the time. They've got a system working. And there have been efforts in the past to address that flooding. It involves private property as well. And there was difficulty getting consent from private property owners to actually do the, it's partly pumping, but it's also partly you're needing to create some flood walls, low flood walls, my recollection. Ran into lack of property owner cooperation. That was many years ago. The Greenbrae 101 project did address, you know, what is considered within the range of sort of normal tidal fluctuations, but we have many spots along the 101 transportation infrastructure, frankly, that in order to deal with a high king tide and a storm event would require elevating the freeways. And I think Caltrans has made the decision in the past that those inconveniences aren't worth the cost of the major elevations. But we actually have to, now it's really staring at us in the face, because with the warming of the, this season's warming of the ocean waters, our tide, a 6-foot tide, is now appearing as a 7-foot tide. It's going to be unbelievable. Our biggest, worse than Lucky, down in Sausalito.
No, I understand.
I don't have an answer for pumps. I don't know that it's just a pump solution. I think it's more complicated than that. And frankly, I'm going to take your question and go back to speak with Diane first of the Corte Madera Council, because she and I have talked a lot about how water's moved around actually in Corte Madera, and we haven't talked about it enough in the sense of how that interface with Caltrans.
Thank you.
It's a good point. And also just a curious fact, that area that we're talking about that floods, it also sinks.
Yes, 12 feet is...
Sinks?
It sinks. So there is literally, I heard a figure, 17 feet of asphalt in those areas. I mean, that's just a not so fun fact, but it's a problematic area for sure. So you know what I'm going to do? I'm happy to stay here and keep taking questions if people want to ask questions, but also release you to go. And I know this young lady wanted to have a conversation with me. A little bit, I'm thinking she was going to ask me about something other people didn't want to hear about.
Katie, I want to say...
So you're going to stay.
Before we wrap up, I want to say, I think Hal used to say, no pothole too small.
No pothole too small.
And obviously, he was your mentor, if I can use that phrase. And I want to thank you publicly for getting rid of that stripe that was down the middle of Vista Grande, and it ran down Los Cerros, and it ran after Sir Francis Drake.
Oh, yeah.
And it was actually very dangerous. I was in the car with an octogenarian, and he was about to slam into the back of a car because he thought it was dividing a road.
Oh, yeah,
he thought
it
was
like it.
So, and when you became alerted to that, within about 2 weeks, that was gone. They came and brushed it out, and it had been there a year. So I just want to thank you for that and let everyone know that, you know, we've talked about a lot of regional issues and countywide issues, but you're there for us when something local needs help.
Yeah, thank you, and I appreciate that. Actually, I did talk about sort of bigger regional issues in terms of throughout the Ross Valley and or regionally, but this job is a lot about actually responding to the calls about a pothole or about a stripe in the road or about a neighborhood issue, or even creating some sort of mediation between neighborhoods and schools or have you. It's a lot of very, very local neighborhood stuff, and that's the fun work, and that's the more gratifying work than these larger, almost intractable issues that we've been talking about today. But we have to keep working on this. But I did want to mention, in Green Bay specifically, beyond removing a stripe, we're actually patching together. I've met with several neighborhood groups where we've got issues around speeding, running stop signs, and looking at ways, how can we do a little bit of striping should we be having reduced speeding on whatever roads, which is a little hard to accomplish, towards making it safer within the neighborhoods. And a whole package of those are going to be put together. I actually would like to come to Green Property Owners Association to share towards implementing them next summer, when I believe there's quite a bit of Green Bay road work being planned, which is an inconvenience, but it's put up with the construction for the improved infrastructures.
Question, would it be you or our Green Bay Property Owners Association representative to ask about finding ways to stop parking on both sides of the street on my little quarter, Cordova, which really is restricting access into our cul-de-sac street? It's a recent happening. All it seems to take is just a sign saying don't park on this side of the street, or what I'm willing to do is pass out notices to those locally on the cars. If there's a car parked on the other side of the street, please don't park on the opposite side, since you never know who's first and who's second.
Right.
But that's really been happening a lot lately.
Yeah, and the behavior changes.
I dread that fire truck that's going to try and get through.
So that's a call to Jack or to me, and then to make a change, we'd go out and have the traffic engineer look at it and see, because that's...
Okay, well, I'll do my little notes first.
You can definitely...
Right, so putting a sign up is a county.
It is a county, and we wouldn't just go put a sign up until making sure that's the right response.
Right. I'd much rather just have cooperation.
Well, so that's maybe...
Thank you.
That's maybe something I could help you with
okay.
to try and talk to people,
yeah.
but as you
yeah,
probably
often
know from experience, not everybody's reasonable.
But it is, and
thank
also,
you.
I mean, it's just another example of whatever's happening with the economy is changing, it's changing behaviors, and there's traffic patterns that are changing, there's parking patterns that are changing. I got the Woodland area over in Lameda Park. We have traffic coming through there, and we have people parking. Never in decades, no one ever parked there. And suddenly, is it overflow from whatever business? Is it commuter parking? So things have not remained status quo. There's impacts coming from outside, and so then we need to respond. And so that's so. I'll put it on my list.
I know where to go if I'm ineffective.
Yeah, I like it though, the idea of putting notes in windshields. Actually, I think neighborhood efforts work.
They often do, especially if people don't understand they're causing a problem.
Right. Okay.
I know we're all concerned about traffic, but I do have another issue.
Yeah, that's fine.
I believe that as a member of the Board of Supervisors, you voted against CORN, civic openness and negotiations. And that turned out to be a better decision than we anticipated at the time, because Governor Brown just signed a bill which people have been referring to as the anti-coin coin, where if a local government adopts an ordinance that requires coin, it comes along with a whole bunch of other requirements that would just sink them. So they, you know, it's an effective discouragement for adopting coin as an ordinance. Mm-hmm. But that doesn't mean you can't actually use coin. Mm-hmm. You know, when the negotiations come up, you can publicize the proposed agreement and let people in the community know. What I'd like to know is, what is your view? Why did you oppose coin, and what is your view of how or whether something like that ought to be used?
Okay, good question. So for those who aren't familiar, coin is civic openness in negotiations. A coin. And actually, I didn't oppose coin. I was actually supportive of a couple of the elements proposed in COIN. COIN was looking at how can negotiations between government agencies and labor, which all public agencies go through, become more open to the public, transparent, provide better, if the public not invited into the negotiation itself by actually airing publicly every proposal that goes back and forth, which to me didn't make sense because negotiations just don't work that way. And we saw with BART, as proposals were leaked, the sides dug in their heels, and it led to impasse. But what COIN does propose that I really did agree with was, one, improving advance information and analysis and provide it to the public prior to the county board considering adoption of any labor negotiations. So we actually put in place and started and applied in this last round of negotiations. One, we went beyond the required Brown Act disclosure requirements and noticed potential contracts that were going to be coming on the agenda 2 weeks in advance, maybe was 10 days in one of the examples. We did a much more thorough analysis and provided that in our staff report and to the public around the cost and the different elements of every contract labor negotiation. And I think we had more robust discussions, frankly, about not only the process, but also the contracts as they came up. So I was not opposed to COIN in principle. But I was opposed to every element of COIN I didn't know that all of those elements were going to help negotiations necessarily have a better outcome for the public. But certainly the ask for greater public disclosure, transparency, and information so the layperson can understand what these contracts really mean to the public and to the taxpayer were well placed and adopted by the county. So
when is the next negotiation?
I want to say the bulk of them, there's 12 bargaining groups. I think there's at least 12 bargaining groups. The bulk of those we just did, and I think they're 3-year contracts, but there's a couple others that will be coming up in the interim who are not on the
same
that cycle.
Time cycle, yeah.
Anyway, but thank you for the question. And I guess in hindsight, good way to go.
That was exactly what I was thinking.
But it was not pressing, and I can Yes.
This is related to this in an indirect way, but I think a lot of people don't necessarily pay attention to the negotiations between the county and the work and the public employees, except that they are a public employee.
Yeah, sure.
But I think that it is becoming more and more relevant in that we're hearing about funding problems and there's not enough money. One of the things that was fully funded for decade after decade after decade after decade was the Marin County Public Employee Pension Plan.
Mm-hmm.
It's not solvent anymore. And for me, I just read about this every so often, and I'm thinking for decade after decade, stock market up, stock market down, wars, recessions, whatever, it was fully funded, it was fully solvent. Now it's not.
And it was fully solvent not that long ago. Ultimately, it's relevant because at some point decisions are going to be have to be made. Does Sir Francis Drake Boulevard get paved, or do we pay retirees? But the bigger question, well, maybe you can talk about, at least maybe, how did it get unfunded, given its all these years of being fully funded, and what are we doing today
to get it
solvent?
Yeah, so good question, and over the course of many decades, you're right, fully funded, but probably sometimes dipping under 100%, over, under. In the early 2000s, late 1990s, early 2000s, was a period of multiple years of double-digit returns on the pension fund in terms of, you know, it was forecast for a 7.5% return. I'm not sure if that was the number then. And it was getting double-digit returns. Therefore, it became actually over 100% funded, the county retirement fund. This was happening across actually the state of California. And across the state of California, pressure was brought to bear by labor, by the union groups, to give some of that over-return on investment back to the employees, because the perception was that the public agency was benefiting by this gangbuster economy and stock market, right? So in the early 2000s, Marin County being one of them, but one of the last, counties and jurisdictions across the state actually enhanced benefits. They created an enhanced benefit tier that provided a greater, you know, a lower retirement age and a better benefit in terms of what that retirement rate was. And this was the mistake, I think, the biggest mistake that was made. They rolled in former existing employees who had been hired under contracts that were not as generous into that now more generous tier, if that makes sense. So that meant suddenly there was a bunch of employees that had not been paying in at a certain rate that were going to get a more generous benefit. I mean, I'm really oversimplifying this. So all's good. Pension fund is still fully funded. The actuarials look good if you continue to have these high rates of return, or actually even if you just met the whatever the 7.5% return was, as long as employees only lived so long and collected whatever and collected their retirement till they passed away, all was good. And then the recession hit. And the recession hit, blew out the county retirement fund, as it blew out so many other people's individual savings accounts across the board. So we went from 100% funded, fully funded, to 76%, maybe it was even lower than that, coming out of the recession. That was the big hit, between the retirement, and then add on to that, the fact that now we're getting, the actuarials are projecting longer lifespan for our employees, correct? So that starts to eat away at the fund. So now we have what's called an unfunded liability. And it's not that we pulled funding away from it, it's that the base fund that's returning interest, that's supposed to keep it solvent, got hit by the recession, and our actuarial analysis that was done prior is not playing out in real life. Good news is, we're actually paying it down. So we're down to, it was in the low 70s, high 60% funded at its low point around 2009, 2010. Now we're up at 84%. And that's partly due to returns, increased returns, so the stock market cycle. So now we're actually getting the benefit of the stock market recovering. And also we have been investing one-time monies towards paying down that unfunded liability. And those are the monies you're talking about that maybe could have gone to roads. But it's a financial decision on the part of the county to make an investment in paying down this liability, which will be paid down, if all stays on track, in 15 years. Because it actually reduces our overall cost generally and allows us to control our cash flow.
Yep, yeah.
So, I mean, that's a long-winded answer, but it's not, it's I struggle with a defined benefit, frankly, solution.
Well, if I can add one other thing, and again, we're talking with people in this room and you can see the ages of the people in this room. One of the things that constantly comes up, almost everybody in the private sector has gone away from the traditional pension plan. We are on 401ks.
Yep.
And the question that comes up is, what's so special about the public employees? Why don't we put them on 401ks?
And it's a very valid question, and I think it's one of the options and solutions that we have to be looking at going forward, and the county has. We've called it a hybrid, where we create a tier where we offer new employees an option. Do you want to do 401k? You become more mobile, it has a different kind of benefit, or traditional. We don't have the ability without legislative action in Sacramento to go to a whole 401k type solution. In fact, I think we need to get legislative approval to even do a hybrid. It's not as simple. I think the governor signed in that PEPRA a couple years ago, which actually started to modify how much it reduced the individual jurisdiction's ability to enhance benefits. Actually, it pretty much made it impossible to. It raised the retirement age, did some different things to help modify the benefit structure to make it more reasonable. But again, a defined benefit is a defined benefit until we get to something that's more, frankly, I would like to see a hybrid that's partly defined benefit, partly defined contribution. County employees don't get Social Security. We need to have some sort of baseline for sure, right?
Yes.
Retirement. But we also, I do think there's something to be said for everyone has to share the risk and the rewards of the stock market and return rates on their pension funds. But it's not simple, and I'm not an economist.
Well, this didn't just happen in California. If
no.
you look at the news in Rhode Island and Chicago is actually the first place that isn't paying their bills because they've run out of money. And it also, the government accounting rules, which tell you that you're 84% funded now, actually not accurate. You're not that highly funded. If the government accounting rules ever get straightened out so that it really reflects what you've got, you're going to find out that it's less than 84% when the current figures tell you it's 84%. I don't know when that's going to hit the fan. But
well, and that 84% is actually just a moment in time, too. So
right.
But actually, GASB, the government accounting rules, they did change over the last few years, and those numbers do reflect whatever our unfunded liability is, and it treats those numbers differently. And again, I'm not an accountant, but we actually, those have to be reflected in our accounting, and I believe in our pension fund, unfunded liability assessment, so. Okay, should I let you all go? Do we want to thank some people over here?
Yeah, yes.
Marin?